Right now, my guest is one Simon Reynolds. He's a great writer, he's a great musicologist, music historian, and at times, a critic. But he's also a fan of music, and he's a fan of vinyl. And I have a lot of questions for him, so I hope he's ready. Simon, you wrote a book years ago called Rip It Up and Start Again, which is about punk and post-punk, how punk basically, for lack of a better word, kind of exploded, fell apart, and from it comes post-punk. It's a big tome, and it's a huge subject. What did you learn by taking that massive chunk of music history on?
I think I learned that a lot of the people in that time didn't really appreciate how exciting a time they lived through. And they were, you know, when I approached a lot of these artists, I said, I'm doing a book on post-punk, and they were like, well, what's that then? And then when I interviewed them, it all started coming back to them. They'd almost forgotten what an amazing era it was. And they were like, now I understand why you're talking about post-punk. It was a term that existed at the time in the music press, but it was more took hold by the mid-80s as that was the post-punk era. And it sort of basically meant any band who might have been inspired by the Pistols or the Clash or the Ramones, but didn't just want to repeat the first Ramones album, the first Clash album over and over again. To me, the more interesting development out of punk was the groups who said, well, what do we do now? You know, how do we take this music further? And so you got this interesting thing where you have bands who aren't skilled at all, but they're trying to get more sophisticated. Right. And often you have like a mix of people who really can't sing or play, and then other people who actually turn out to be like really good drummers or really good guitarists. And Susie and the Banshees would be a good example. You know, Susie is not a conventionally great singer, but she developed an amazing voice and power of her own. Steve Severin, not a trained bassist, but then they had, in the second incarnation of the band, they had John McGeert, this great guitarist. They had this fantastic drummer, Budgie, and they just evolve and evolve. Each album is a sort of step forward, you know. So I think it's this, post-punk was this period when they tried to sort of keep their edge and the aggression and the dark, you know, the dark or challenging content of punk, but sort of musically expand and go forward, you know.
Why do you think a scene starts, and why do you think like a music movement like punk rock, how do you think it starts, and why do you think a music scene or movement ends?
Well, that's a big question. I think with punk, everyone's frustrated. That's what they had in common. They were frustrated with the status quo of music and the fact that, you know, there was, you know, music seemed out of reach to kids starting out, you know, you couldn't have a hope of ever getting a record deal. And then these basic revolutionary ideas like you can actually record and release your own music. You don't have to practice for 5 years in your bedroom before you can get on a stage if you've got something urgent to say. That sort of liberated people, and then they had to sort of work out, well, what do we want to say? And some of them wanted to sort of say, well, we're going to leave rock music behind altogether. We're going to experiment with electronic music. And others wanted to sort of work with guitars and bass, but like push them in new directions and take ideas from dub and funk and jazz and, you know, all these different sources. And then, you know, yeah, the goth thing, you know, all these different directions. And in my book, I'm trying to sort of tell the story of how all these different paths came out. If you were to play a Throbbing Gristle record next to a Susie and the Banshees record, next to an Echo the Bunnymen record, you know, you wouldn't necessarily see that they have anything in common, but they all start from that starting point of punk.
What makes a scene or a movement fall apart?
I think with most sort of musical genres or movements, it's almost like a set of resources. Like at a certain point, you've taken it as far as you can, and you just have to do something different. And so with post-punk, to me, it seemed to start ending anyway in around about 83, when people started to think, well, this has become a bit too conceptual and a bit too bloodless and thought out. And, you know, where's the passion? Where's the sort of magic in a way? So I think, you know, I think musical movements seem to sort of reach a dead end, and they have to sort of step sideways into something else eventually. It's almost like all the listenable, enjoyable options get used up, and you just have like pure abstract noise or something, and which isn't that enjoyable.
So when you pick a topic to write about, and it's going to be several months or maybe years of work to make one book happen, how do you find that topic?
Most of my books about music have been about are people who, they might be flawed individuals, but they're kind of heroes in a way. They're choosing the path of most resistance. They're trying to do something interesting and unusual in a business that you know, doesn't always reward that and puts up obstacles to it. And so my books tend to be, you might say, like clusters of heroic narratives. You know, each chapter will focus on the story of a band or a couple of bands or a scene in a town, and these people trying to create something out of almost nothing. You know, just, you know, some stray inspirations, whatever. There might be spaces in their town that they can use as a club or a crappy recording studio locally. Some other person in their town who's often the heroes are. Heroes in these stories are non-musicians, but people who start fanzines or start a club, start a label. They're like catalysts in some other way. So in a weird way, I think that's the thing that grabs me is these, you know, it's a classic story of the misfit, the plucky individualist who is just trying to shake things up, trying to, you know, make their mark. They often have a bit of ego driving them. I think that's an essential part. Right. Of artistry, really, is wanting to shout your name out there. But they're also trying to do something different, strange, confrontational, and it's, you know, a challenge. You know, there's a struggle involved.
How do you, as a music historian, and in a way a critic, but you're also a music fan. Yeah. I mean, it's obvious from your writing, you love music. You talk about records and, you know, the closet full of vinyl and all of that. Do you ever have any difficulty separating the fan from someone who has to be very objective and clear-eyed to write accurately and try and understand a scene or whatever you're writing about?
I think I try and be fair, but I think if you don't have an angle, and an angle could be like a positive angle where you just think someone's great, or it could be a negative angle. I think without that sort of passionate edge, it just becomes a kind of rather dry survey. And so I tend to avoid, if I can, writing about groups where I'm not excited by some fact of their existence, whether it's the story could be very compelling or it's the music itself, ideally both. You know, the story of Public Image is great, this dysfunctional crew of people, but the music is just insanely weird and interesting, and the fact they actually in the UK had pop hits, you know, with some of these mad singles is just unbelievable, really. I can't believe it happened. I can't believe I saw it on TV as a kid growing up. There are things that I try and understand, like in the Retromania book. I'm not a big fan of I love the original 60s garage punk. I'm not a big fan of the revivalism of it. I don't think it's not how I would devote my life to being in a band that's a replica of the Chocolate Watch Band or the Count Five or whatever. But in that book, I tried to understand that culture from when I interviewed Billy Childish about all his theories about music, brilliant thinker about art and music. And I tried to understand how someone would devote their whole life to talk to me seems like living in the past. And sort of see the honor in that. You know, it's actually quite a strong statement to sort of say, this is what music should have been. All rock music went the wrong direction. This is what we think it should have stayed at. So, you know, I have done writing where I'm not that big a fan of the music, but I find value in the passion and the belief and the dedication of other people, you know.
Right. I remember in Rip It Up and Start Again, you talk a lot about Gang of Four. Mm-hmm. And I think that was a band that really meant something to you.
Yeah.
And so do you have like analog feelings that tie into vinyl that you don't necessarily get from popping a CD in or streaming? Because to me, just my opinion, I think there's a real connection one makes with one's records. You know, there's something about it.
I don't know if it's just the, you know, when I was born and the age I was when I acquired records, you know, most of my warm feelings about musical artifacts are to do with vinyl and the, you know, the packaging and the ritual of getting the separate discs out of a metal box, you know, and not, you know, not wanting to scratch it, but, you know, they've made it really quite hard for you to get the discs out. And you pull out old records that you might, I might have bought something from a few years ago that was pressed in the 70s, and the sound is just so vivid and warm. You know, it also relates to, you know, that time I had a lot less music. You know, I can remember when I, you know, when I had the slits cut or metal box, I probably had a dozen records, maybe 20, you know, I had very meager financial resources. Every purchase was like fraught with anxiety, you know, like, right. Is this, you know, this is a couple of weeks of working on the egg stall in the market in my town, you know, going into this album, have I made the right choice, you know, and sometimes you make the wrong choice and you try and play this record 15 times hoping it would click with you finally and get that, you know, and I think that's a, you know, I think that's one of the things that's been lost with music effectively being free, whether you do it the legal way of streaming it, whether you download illegally or you can hear nearly everything on YouTube, is the investment of your labor time that you had, or your allowance if you, you know, if you're a kid, but often, like, you know, young people working in lousy jobs, it's a significant chunk of their time that they're then putting into these commodities they buy, and it actually gives it an emotional intensity, you know, the choice of picking a record, taking it home, and the anticipation, getting out the paper bag or whatever, or the plastic bag, and whacking it on your stereo. It's all very, you know, it builds excitement, anticipation, and then this strong bond.
When you go to shows and you see people either filming themselves or texting, or the band is this kind of this thing, or the musical event is this thing in the background, and they're going home and their music source is, you know, from a phone or a laptop or a streaming service, what do you reckon they're missing out on?
It does seem to suggest a certain kind of an odd standing outside the experience,
right?
Not fully immersing it and seeing a value in it as this thing that you sort of document, and there's a sort of contradiction between that and the fact that, you know, these music events are supposed to be in the now, you're lost in the moment, you're fully immersed, and also unrepeatable as well, you know. And the fact that also that then you get so much of it online with people documenting it then sort of creates this thing where people could feel like, well, I won't go to the show because I'll see what people put on, right, on YouTube, you know. But that's not the same as being there. You don't get the smell, you don't get the heat of other bodies next to you, you don't get the, you know, seeing a band live, going to a dance club or whatever, is so much more than just the pixel version.
Right. You know? Yeah, I like coming home from a show and kind of reeking. Like, okay, you know, I sweated through my clothes. I smell like the guy who's bumping into me half the night.
Other people sweat on you.
Yeah, and like that's kind of part of it for me. And I'm not looking to like rub myself on people all night. But when you come home, like, I just have been through something.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't mind that at all. It's kind of what I put my money down for. I'm not running into people. I'm just saying, like, I don't want it to be nothing. Yeah. And I go to shows pretty often. And if it's a band I'm into, man, I'm singing along, or I look funny. Mm-hmm. And people recognize me, and they'll come up and be like, I'm like, whoa, what? Like, I can't believe you're talking to me. Like, aren't you here for this? And I don't want to be rude to anyone, and I have to really be polite. Like, excuse me, I'm here to do this now. So can you please not be such a lightweight? And I can't say that, because they're not trying to be. They're just having a completely different experience of this thing than I am, due to how we access music. And that's why I brought the topic up, because you and I, we're not 20 anymore. And so we come from a more analog, in the moment reality of the live show and the playback environment. And so coming down to playback environment, you buy records, you have them. Do you still buy them?
I buy them occasionally. I've kind of reached that point where I've got so many that I feel like I should listen to the ones I have. And I have a lot that I bought that I haven't even listened to. You know, I've been in record stores since 16, so since the late 70s. I've spent so much time in them, and I still see groups I've never heard of, and or artwork, you know, maybe a group I have heard, but it, like the US artwork is completely different. Sometimes very strange, you know, things you would never thought would have come out, strange recorded field recordings or spoken word records. You know, there's just, there was this phonographic tsunami, this is sort of huge bulge of recording and releasing in the second half of the 20th century, and it's all out there, you know, and you can still find completely unfathomably strange things amongst this stuff.
So analog, the turntable, the vinyl still has presence in your life.
Definitely, yeah.
And whenever you can, you get the you get it going. Can you remember the first record you bought that really moved you? More than just some something you heard on the radio and you put it on, but something that you put on and it just changed something in your life, or really just really knocked you out.
I think it would be this probably the second album I bought, which was Cut by the Slits, and it just was so strange sounding and amazing, you know. Harmony seems like the wrong word to describe the backing vocals of the Slits, but they are like these this incredible lattice of voices. It's not Fleetwood Mac, but it's like, you know, Ari Up's multi-track voices and the voices of the other members of the Slits all meshing in these wonderfully awkward yet piercing kind of combinations. The amazing drumming. I think on the record it's actually Budgie before Budgie. He was in Susie and the Banshees playing. Viv Albertine's amazing little guitar licks. The lyrics are just phenomenal. The artwork is, you know, quite
iconic.
Striking artwork. And the inner sleeve has all these great strange scribble drawings, I think that Ari Up did, or maybe it was Tessa, the bassist. It's just it's just a thing that I would have played 100 times at least, when, you know, partly because I only had two albums at that point. The other record, which I also loved, was by Ian Dury and the Blockheads, Do It Yourself. Fantastic record.
If you were to encounter someone, age doesn't matter, and they want to get into an analog version of music, you know, they want to get away from the CDs and whatever, and they want to start buying records, would you have any basic suggestions?
I think, you know, I think the thing that people would probably find, someone who's grown up in this age would find the strangest part of getting into vinyl is this thing of like, you sort of had to submit to analog time, you know. Obviously you can pick up the needle and jump to your favorite track and replay it over, but really it's all about like surrender, really. You just surrender to the flow of the record, and that's how you find out actually the track that you don't like, on the first hearing or even the second hearing, actually it turns out to be one of the best things on the record, you know. And I think that's what I think people almost have to retrain themselves to do, or if they've, you know, really to learn how to do it. Playing an album is, you're sort of like submitting in a way to the band's vision. People put a lot of trouble into sequencing an album, you know, whether it's Dark Side of the Moon or Talking Heads records, you know, the choice of which track comes after that track, you know, was freighted with a lot of significance, and it could make or break a record because it's a big part of, you know, the experience. So I think that's the thing that I would say might be surprising for younger people getting into vinyl, is you still have the consumer power of choosing which records to buy or whatever, but once you're playing them, you're really just kind of going with the artist's vision, I think.